We're still here at Prismic with Guillermo, and now I want to talk about another topic of serverless, deploying globally. Imagine I had a website or an application, I deployed it, and you know I have a global success, international. How does serverless adapt to that?
So there are two patterns here that I like to think about. So a CDN, which is the typical strategy for caching your assets everywhere, works really well with static files and static assets. So when you use our platform, for example, like we automatically cache all your static files in every edge of the world. But the question that comes up is like, what happens to dynamic data? Like not everything can be modeled as a static file. So what happens when you have to render HTML that composes a headless CMS, for example, or you have to make queries to a database on demand as a user comes in? So if you're using serverless, you can decide to deploy your functions everywhere in the world. So the CDN becomes a lot more smart. It can return static files immediately, close to where your customer is. It can invoke a function, and then it can cache the result of that function, which is super interesting, because if you remember from our previous conversation, when you invoke a serverless function, you're basically handling an HTTP request.
Right.
And that means that you're responding with HTTP headers and a body and or maybe an image content. So in the headers, you can say cache control and cache your asset.
But just before even doing the caching, I like this metaphor about CDN and relating it to a CDN. Because even imagine you don't have caching. Even if you don't have, you still can deploy that function and run it in anywhere around the world, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So it's closer to the client anyway,
absolutely.
Even if you don't have caching.
And I think that the interesting thing here is not only are you getting a scalability benefit, you're getting a reliability benefit. Because the analogy that I like to use is no one ever stresses or gets paged because their image is down at the CDN. So there's no mental conception that your CDN could go offline or that one of your assets.
Because it's a simple model, right? Because it's just a file.
It's simple, and the model itself ensures that there's no monitoring or observability necessary. We call this like health checks. You don't have to health check your processor, your server to make sure it's up and running. Everything loads on demand. So basically, serverless is making the CDN smart. It's making it application aware.
Right. So basically what happens is that you save the function somewhere in a global storage, and then you invoke it on demand.
So it gets a little tricky because one of the things that we have to remember is where your source of data is. So if you have your database in the east of the United States, you have it in Virginia, and then you're trying to execute your function in China, you have to compensate for, you know, there's going to be a lot of round trips
between
China and the US. And if your code runs a lot of logic serially, it might actually be a disadvantage
if you separate them away.
Exactly. So what I always tell our users and our customers is you have to think about placing your functions near your data. And I think there's a new category of application that emerges as a result, which is kind of also in the same vibe of increasing regulation and data ownership and borders around data, is the idea that you can replicate your data or that data should belong to where the citizens of a certain country are.
Closer to the users.
Yes. So you could imagine that a more realistic model for serverless is that China, and I believe they're already doing this, says, you know, I don't want to be in the same database as every US customer in the East Coast.
And then you call GDPR that says the same, right?
So your database might actually be in China, and this actually also solves your latency problems.
Right.
So I think it's...
Yeah, I fully agree. And you know, there's something that we try always to solve for people is that, you know, as a platform, whenever you have data, you need also to make that data available the closest possible to where they are consumed, right?
Correct. It's logical, right? Like
right.
You wouldn't want to transact with a foreign country when you're dealing with your own local problems.
Right.
So serverless is very natural, I think, for how databases will evolve.
So basically, serverless works the best when the platform also is taking, the platform that is hosting data is also working in the same kind of model of distributing data.
Yeah, I would say that what we're seeing today for code, if I had to hazard a prediction, I would say what we're seeing with code is going to happen very, very soon to data. So we're seeing today that code has been broken down into primitives, like the function, and that functions don't have borders. You can quickly, instantly deploy them wherever you need or wherever your business is. But databases, we still think of them as servers with connection pools and limits of connections and so on. Not all databases, of course, and I think that's why I'm a big fan of when your data can be modeled as a headless CMS, for example. Like, I think that solves a lot of my database problems. But for traditional databases, they have to evolve, and we're starting to see this, to make your data more ready for replication.
And also for moving, because replication is one of the problems. And then people will come up with sharding and all these tactics. But
absolutely.
They are kind of not dynamic enough sharding. You need to be able to move things
exactly.
around.
Exactly. It's almost like you want a customer level sharding.
That's what we do, actually. Sharding. And it should be deep in the architecture, exactly on the server, where you have packets of data and you can send them wherever you want to be.
Yeah, because I think it makes total sense. For example, if you have customers in China that have lots of popular deployments for China, why are you replicating all the data of every possible customer in the US who might never interact with your API endpoint in China? So I think that we're all going towards a very, very nice future.
Some kind of multi-tenant database.
Yes, I would say probably multi-master, that you can not only read from the replica, but write in that location.
Yeah, unfortunately, when we had to search for that, there were no technology. We had to write our own. You know, sometimes you regret writing a database system.
Because
sometimes
you wanted future earlier. Yeah.
Next video, we'll talk more about the developer experience of serverless and how does it impact their experience.